थैंक यू। सो आई विल बिगिन द स्टोरीज ऑफ द कॉन्स्टलेशंस फ्रॉम परहैप्स द मोस्ट फेमस कॉन्स्टलेशंस विच इज इन द नॉर्थ विच इज कॉल्ड द बिग डिपर और द ग्रेट बियर। So these seven stars, I hope the cursor is also visible. So these the group of these seven stars in the Western asterism, it is known as the Big Dipper, and in our Indian mythology it has been denoted as the seven rishis or Sapta rishis. So I'll start with the story of the great bear in Greek mythology. So this is the great bear, this one. Zeus, the king of gods, fell in love with a young woman called Callisto. This made his wife Hera jealous, so she began to watch him carefully. One day when Zeus and Callisto were walking in the forest, he saw Hera coming their way. Since he didn't want her to make a scene, she turned Callisto into a huge bear. He then met Hera and went back to Mount Olympus, their abode, with his wife Hera, hoping he could later return and transform Callisto into human form again. Unfortunately, Callisto's son Arcas was hunting in the same woods at that same time. When he saw the bear, he decided to target it, and so he stalked it, and when he was in the correct position, let fly an arrow that pierced its heart. Imagine this shock when the dying bear turned into his mother. Overcoming with grief, he began to cry. Zeus heard him weeping and realized that had happened and realized what had happened. He didn't want Hera to hear Arcas and find out what had happened. So he turned both the mother and the son into constellations and sent them into the sky. Callisto became the Ursa Major. The bigger bear became the Ursa Major, and Arcas, the son of Callisto, became the Ursa Minor. Here is the Ursa Minor. The story goes that Arcas turned to see his mother while being placed in the sky, and so the little bear is turning towards his mother, towards the great bear. And the brightest star in the Ursa Minor is nothing but the Polaris, which is also known as Dhruv Tara in Indian mythology. These stories always fascinated humans, and they made the night sky more fun for us. Another interesting story about the another constellation called Cassiopeia goes like this. So here is Cassiopeia. So you see this W-shaped constellation. This is called Cassiopeia. So how does the story about the Cassiopeia goes? So in Greek mythology, Cassiopeia was the wife of King Cepheus. According to the legend, she boasted she was more beautiful than the sea nymphs called Nereids. Well, Nereids were considered as a very beautiful creatures. So this Cassiopeia always boasted about her beauty. Her boast angered Poseidon, the god of the sea, who sent a sea monster, Cetus, to ravage the kingdom. To pacify the monster, Cassiopeia's daughter कैसोपिया हैज अ वेरी ब्यूटिफुल डॉटर कॉल एंड्रोमेडा. एंड्रोमेडा इज ऑल्सो प्लेस अराउंड कैसोपिया ओनली. आई शो दैट इन अ मोमेंट. सो टू पेसिफाई दैट मॉन्स्टर प्रिंसेस एंड्रोमेडा वॉज लेफ्ट टाइड ऑन अ रॉक बाय द सी सो दैट द मॉन्स्टर कैन ईट एंड्रोमेडा. सीटस वॉज अबाउट टू डेवर हर वेन पर्शियस द हीरो लुक्ड डाउन अपॉन हर फ्रॉम पेगासस. सो ही वॉज राइडिंग द हॉर्स कॉल्ड पेगासस. पेगासस वॉज अ फ्लाइंग हॉर्स. पर्शियस रेस्क्यूड द प्रिंसेस एंड्रोमेडा एंड दे ऑल लिव्ड हैप्पीली. द गॉड वेर सो प्लीज्ड दैट ऑल ऑफ दीज कैरेक्टर्स वेर एलिवेटेड टू द हेवेंस एज स्टार्स. सो हियर दिस W साइन इज द कैसोपिया. दिस स्मॉल गैलेक्सी दैट यू सी हियर इज द एंड्रोमेडा गैलेक्सी which you can find near the constellation Cassiopeia. So, and this is also the nearest galaxy to our Milky Way, the Andromeda. Okay. So, if I open, okay. So here the Andromeda is tied with a stone and here is Cassiopeia. Even after going to the sky, he is still embracing her beauty by looking into the mirror. So, and this Cassiopeia suffered an indignity. Her vanity caused her to bound on a chair and placed in the heavens so that she revolves around the north celestial pole, which is here, which is the Polaris. So she revolves around the Polaris all the time, and half of the year she is visible inverted, okay, because she was cursed by the gods. Then this is Perseus, who saved Andromeda. He is Perseus, okay, and this is his horse Pegasus. You may find that these figures are little exaggerated. In the sky you will see these dots, and by connecting these dots they have imagined these figures and constructed stories around them. Okay. Now next story is about Pleiades. Pleiades is again an interesting structure in the night sky. So Pleiades will be visible near the, if this is Scorpius, then here is Betelgeuse, and which are Pleiades ke pass mein sun hai. Wait, if let me see if I can remove the sun for the moment so you can see this, see that part more clearly. Okay, now it is visible slightly better. So this is Pleiades cluster, which is a group of cluster here. If I this is the Pleiades cluster. The story about Pleiades goes like this. The seven stars in Pleiades represents the seven wives of the seven sages in the constellation Saptarishi. So in the Saptarishi constellation, which is this one, okay, so these are the seven sages and their wives are here in the Pleiades clusters according to Indian mythology. The names of these stars are Amba, Dula, Vityani, Abhrayanti, Meghadhanti, Varshayanti, and Kupanika. So, and according to Greek mythology, Atlas, father of seven sisters, was sent to God to support universe. To pacify the sad sisters, they were even given place in the heaven. Through the telescope, you can see lot of stars, not just seven, but there are more than seven stars, but with a naked eye, around six or seven are visible. And in the Indian name for this Pleiades cluster is Kritika. This is called Kritika Nakshatra. The next constellation that we are going to talk about is Bootes, which is should be here somewhere here. Just a second. Yes, here it is. Bootes. So Bootes again is a hunter. So Egyptian regarded Bootes as a herdsman, and according to another legend, Bootes was the inventor of the plough, the one that he is carrying in his hand. He is regarded as the inventor of the plough, and Ursa Major was plough itself. So many other civilizations visualized these constellations in different ways. So this is imagined as a plough. The most accepted version about the Bootes are that he is a hunter along with these two dogs, who is after this great bear. Okay, so this hunter is chasing this great bear. Now, another famous constellation in the night sky is Orion. The most prominent constellation that you will see in the winter season is this Orion. So there are several stories about the Orion hunter. The first one goes as, according to one version of the myth, Orion was a son of poor shepherd called Hyrieus. Once Zeus, Hermes, and Poseidon, these three are gods, stopped by Hyrieus's house. Hyrieus was so generous with his guest that he killed the only animal he had, an ox. So he killed an ox to serve these three guests. Hyrieus was not aware that his guests were gods. The gods wanted to reward Hyrieus generously by granting him a wish. Hyrieus' biggest desire was to have a child. When Hyrieus was gifted with a son, Orion, the child became a very handsome and strong man. He was such a good hunter that he was hired by the king Oenopion to kill the furious beast that were terrifying the inhabitants of the island Chios. Happy for his success, Orion said he would kill all the wild animals on the earth. But the earth goddess Gaia was the name of the earth goddess in Greek mythology, who was the mother of all animal and was not pleased with Orion's intention that he would kill all the animals. Then the mother earth set an enormous scorpion on the Orion. So there is also a scorpion in the sky, which is placed here. दिस इज स्कॉर्पियो, परहैप्स दिस इज द मोस्ट इजिएस्ट कॉन्स्टेलेशन दैट रिजेंबल्स एन एक्चुअल स्कॉर्पियन. आई विल ट्राई टू पुट दिस इन पर्सपेक्टिव. सो हियर यू सी द शेप ऑफ द स्कॉर्पियो, द टेल ऑफ द स्कॉर्पियो. With three tentacles. Tentacles. Okay, so next part of the story. So the goddess Earth sent the Scorpio after the Orion, who was about to kill all the animals. कहाँ चला गया? हाँ, here is the Orion. She also placed Orion in the stars in front of the scorpion so that he is being chased forever for not respecting the animals and the environment. So the Scorpio is placed exactly opposite to just a second. So Scorpio was placed exactly opposite to the Orion. If you observe in the night sky, you will either spot Scorpion or the Orion, because Orion is afraid of the Scorpion. So the moment Scorpion rises in the sky, the Orion sets. And in Indian mythology, this Orion is regarded as the मृग नक्षत्र. ओके, सो दिस इज विजुअलाइज्ड एज अ डेड बियर विच इज लाइंग ऑन द ग्राउंड. सो दिस इज द हेड ऑफ द डियर. दीज आर द फोर लिम्स, दिस 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 एंड दिस. एंड इन द मिडल यू सी दिस थ्री डॉट्स आर द एरो. दिस इज द एरो. And this is considered to be killed by, this deer is killed by Vyadh Rishi, who is this Sirius, brightest star in the brightest object in the night sky is this Sirius, and this is regarded as Vyadh Rishi in Indian mythology, and he is considered as the one who killed this deer. And there's one more story about the Orion in Mahabharata, which refers as that this Orion is considered as Skanda, who is one of the son of Lord Shiva, six-headed son of Lord Shiva. He was both the god of war and the generals of the god, the general of the gods, riding a red crested cork and blowing fearful sounds on a four conch shell. He thrust his spear into the white mountain, and the top of that mountain splits off into the sky, becoming the Milky Way. So it is considered that Skanda threw a bow to a mountain, and the top of the mountain scattered in the sky to form this Milky Way. Now, after these famous constellations, we will head towards the zodiac signs. So, zodiac signs are the special constellations because the sun passes through all these 12 zodiac signs. So, if you see the path of the sun, so these are the zodiac signs, which are Gemini, Cancer, Leo, Virgo, Libra, Scorpion, and so on. We'll go through each of them and see what are the stories behind them. The first zodiac constellation, that is Aries, which is here. Okay, this is Aries. The Indian name for Aries is Mesh Rasi. You might have heard about it. In Indian astronomical conception, the constellation is considered as Ashwini or Ashwamukha, the one who has a horse head, whose face is like a horse. Ashwini is in one of the ancient texts. Ashwini is described as being an anxious to learn Madhu Vidya from sage Dadhichi. Indra threatened Dadhichi that he would chop his head off if he taught his skills. Ashwini suggested that the head of Dadhichi, which contained all the knowledge, could be removed and in its place a horse head would be placed. So when Indra cut Dadhichi's head, it was only the horse's head that was removed and not Dadhichi's head, which the Dadhichi's head, which was full of knowledge. But according to Greek mythology, Ares, or the ram in Greek mythology, it is pronounced as ram. Ares, which is also known as ram in Greek mythology, could fly and was covered with golden fleece. This ram was brought by Mercury for the king of Thessalis, two children, and was given a place in the sky. The next constellation is next to Aries is this Taurus. Okay, so the Y-shaped constellation, if you trace these stars, this it will form an Y-shaped constellation. So these two are the horns of the Taurus. Okay, these are considered as the horns of the Taurus. The Indian name for Taurus is Rishabh Rashi. Taurus occupies a very important and prominent place in most of the ancient cultures. Mohenjo-daro represents this civilization prior to the one which is called the Vedic period, post-historic period. A horse with a horn, an elephant, and a bull were most common pictures in those times. Coins also carried impressions of a bull among the other symbols. The bull is regarded as incarnation of God. The brightest star in this constellation is called Aldebaran. Okay, this is the brightest star in this constellation. Okay, this is Venus. This is a planet and not a part of this constellation. Planets are were named as the roaming stars or wanderers because they move around the sky. So this is called Aldebaran, and the Indian name for Aldebaran is Rohini. This Aldebaran or the Rohini is the eye of the bull. It is a red color star. According to Chileans, Taurus represents an illuminated bull which collided against the sun and caused the onset of spring. So after this Taurus who strike the sun and this onsets this spring. In the ancient time, that is around 4500 BC to 1850 BC, the vernal equinox was actually in Taurus. So these stories made them to remember when different seasons are going to start. So that's why Taurus was regarded as someone who caused the onset of spring. And according to Greek mythology, Jupiter, the great ruler of Olympus, changed himself into a white bull. He carried Europa, the princess, on his back and swam to an island to the sea. The figure of constellation Taurus is like swimming bull. See, if you see, only the head of the bull is visible because this bull is swimming inside the water and only the head is outside the water. Okay. And the constellation next to Taurus, or the sunshine, the zodiac sign after the Taurus is Gemini. Gemini, and the Indian name for Gemini is Mithun. And they lie near the Milky Way, okay, the edge of Milky Way. So if you see this patch that is running across the sky, okay, this patch, this is the edge of our Milky Way. Okay, so here are this constellation called as Gemini, and the most prominent stars in Gemini constellations are Pollux and Castor. They are also known as twin in Western astronomy. Their feet are among the stars near to the edge of Milky Way. Their feet, okay, they fall in the edge of Milky Way. The heads of the twin extend towards the northwest in the same direction as the horns of the Taurus. So these horns, they both indicate in the same direction, in the northeast direction. The bull, the prominent stars in Gemini are Castor and Pollux. According to Greek mythology, Castor and Pollux were the son of Leda and brothers of Helen of Troy. These twins were known for their bravery. One of the best known exploits of these brave twins was a journey after the golden fleece of the ship Argo. Even today, when these stars appear in the sky, sailors predict fair weather. So if these stars are visible in the sky, that means the weather is going to be nice. Gemini includes Ardra and Punaryo. In Sanskrit, Ardha means wet, and when sun reaches this constellation, it should be rainy season. Okay, so in earlier times, when sun would reach this constellation, that means the monsoon season has arrived. But this is not true now. Due to this precession of equinox, the equinox shifts with time. So today the equinox doesn't lie in Gemini constellation, but earlier it used to be. And the constellation next to Gemini is Cancer. The next constellation, this constellation Cancer, is in the western sky, somewhere halfway between Castor and Pollux. Okay. The bright star in Gemini and Regulus. So, wait. And the bright star of Leo. Okay. So, this is halfway between Regulus and Castor. Can you just hold on for a second? Yeah, sorry for that disturbance. Yeah, so I was talking about this Cancer constellation, which is halfway between Pollux Castor and Regulus. Regulus is the brightest star in the another constellation, which is Leo. So according, what is the story behind this constellation? So according to Greek mythology, while Hercules was fighting Hydra, the king of the snake, so there is another constellation in the sky which is called Hydra, which we will see later. So Hercules, which is also present in the night sky, who was fighting with that Hydra, the snake, king of snake in fact, and he was bitten by a crab as introduced by Juno. So Juno told this crab to go and bite Hercules. Hercules destroyed both the snake and the crab, but Juno did not like this, and so he rewarded the crab by placing it among the stars as a constellation. Sun used to be in this constellation when passing through to northernmost part to the ecliptic, known as summer solstice, which falls on 21st June, hence around 23 degree and a half north way was called Tropic of Cancer. Okay, since the summer solstice happens when the sun is in this part. And the next constellation after the Cancer or the Crab is Leo, which is a lion constellation. If I switch on the constellation art, you will see this is a lion and this is a crab. Stories goes about the Leo as Leo was the celebrated Nemean lion, which was killed by Hercules as the first of the 12 tasks assigned to him by his cousin Eurytus. This legend is significant because it used to be the hot season in Greece when the sun entered constellation Leo in its annual movement through the ecliptic. In ancient time, the Egyptian used to worship the stars in Leo because at this time the sun used to enter the constellation, causing floods in the river Nile, including a bumper harvest. In ancient Indian time, the rainy season started when the sun reached Leo. The brightest star in this constellation is Regulus. In Indian astronomy, the name of Regulus is Magh. So that is why this Regulus world was called as Magh, because the rainy season would start when sun appears in this constellation. It lies on the ecliptic. In the Upanishads, there is a reference that the year started with Magh. Okay, so in different times, the beginning of year was marked on different times. So there was a time when year was starting in Magh, that is after the monsoon. The next constellation or the zodiac after Leo is Virgo, or the Indian name for Virgo is Kanya. Even this constellation lies on the ecliptic. Sun enters Virgo in the middle of September and come out of it in about 6 weeks. It occupies the largest span in the ecliptic. So because this is also a very long constellation, Sun is in this constellation for a very long time. Among the zodiac constellations covering about 44 degrees, Sun reaches the autumnal equinox and starts moving towards the south, crossing the equator. according to Greek mythology, some shepherds murdered their king. And seeing this, the princess became very sad. Later, she was given a place in the sky as Virgo. In pictorial representation, Virgo does look like a girl. The brightest star is Spica. Okay, this is the brightest star in this constellation called as Spica. Spica means corn of wheat. Okay, so that's why in pictorial representation, the girl is shown holding this corn of wheat. The Indian name is Chaitra. According to present Indian almanac, the year begins with Chaitra. So earlier, the year used to begin with Leo constellation. That is when the sun was in Leo constellation. And today, the year starts when the sun is in this constellation. Okay, we all know that the Indian calendar new year starts with Chaitra month. Now, next to Virgo is Libra or Tula Rashi. Just a second. I hope my voice is audible clearly and even the screen is visible.
Yes.
Okay. Now the next constellation after Virgo is Libra. The ecliptic meets the celestial equator at two points known as equinoxes. The autumnal equinox, which comes on 22nd September, coincided with the entry of the sun in this constellation called Libra. Hence the name Libra, the balance, because on the autumnal equinox, your day and night are of approximately same duration. That is why this constellation was given the name of Libra, because when the sun is in this constellation, your day and night are approximately equal. The constellation resembles a beam balanced with scale pan. So if you try to imagine, it does look like a pan. So this is a flat pan. If I switch off the art, so this look like a pan, okay, which is supported by a beam. The scales indicated the equality of day and night, but this used to be earlier, okay, but now this is no more true. But now the autumnal equinoxes has shifted due to the precession motion of the earth to Virgo. Star Vishakha is the brightest star in this constellation, which is this one. So this is the brightest star in this constellation. Next to Libra is this Scorpio. So the Indian name for Scorpius is Vrishchika, a Vrishchik Rashi. This constellation is easily recognizable as it closely resembles this shape of scorpion. So if you see, even if I switch off the art, you can still see this curved tail of a scorpion. And these three dots as the tentacles of the scorpion. So according to Indian mythology, the four bright stars in the claws of the and the mouth of scorpion, these four stars, including this one, makes the this they make Nakshiras of Vrishabha and Anuradha respectively. The body of scorpion with its three bright stars, okay, this body of the scorpion with these three bright stars constitutes the Nakshatra Jyeshtha or Ketai So this is also a nakshatra. So as per Indian system, the sky or this zodiac belt is divided into 27 nakshatras instead of 12 zodiac signs. Okay, and instead of sun, we used to track, the Indian people used to track the moon. Okay, and they would see where the moon spends more time, and there were 27 nakshatras, and the moon would spend each day in each nakshatras. The bright star of this constellation is a huge red star called this Antares. So this is the brightest star of this constellation. The other prominent one being Zuba. Which is nope. Is wrong. Anyway. So according to Greek legend, this is the poisonous scorpion that stung the mighty Orion. So this scorpion bite on the heel of Orion, but later Juno felt bad about this incident and arranged the Orion. You will see different version of the stories. So in this one, this has, you know, stung on the one of the heel of Orion, and this one keeps chasing the Orion. The next constellation after the Scorpius is Sagittarius, this one. Okay, so this is among the one of the difficult constellation to resemble as a Sagittarius. Many people, including me, likes to call it as a teapot. So it better resembles as a teapot than a Sagittarius, for me at least. So this constellation is Sagittarius, and this is very close to the center of our galaxy. Okay. Okay, let me switch on the art. So the center of the galaxy lies in the constellation Sagittarius. The sun passes through it from mid-December to mid-January. So around from mid-December to January, sun is in this constellation. It is at the most southerly part of the ecliptic. According to Greek mythology, Sagittarius, the archer, is supposed to be a centaur. The centaur has the body of a horse and the head of and the shoulder of a man. You see? So the Sagittarius is having a body of an animal, and the torso or shoulder and head is of a human. So the bright star of this constellation can be joined in different ways to form different figures. Okay, a few different cultures might have joined these stars in a different way to form different structures. Okay, so one of the famous asterism that I told you is about this teapot. Okay, after this Sagittarius, the another one is this, which is called Capricorn or Capricornus, the goat. It lies in the southern half of the ecliptic and is not a very conspicuous constellation because it is small in size also and not that very attractive of a shape. According to legend, Capricornus, the goat, was placed among the constellation to commemorate the adventure of the god Pan. In a fight with a monster, Typhon Everybody ran away in a panic. But Pan, along with others, jumped into a river and were transformed into two fishes and sea goat. The sea goat is Capricornus, and the two fishes form the next constellation, which is called Pisces. Okay. This is Pisces. Okay. There is another version of the same legend. When Greek nymphs and goddesses were bathing in the river, Pan wanted to make fun of them. He became a goat and jumped into the river. When he did this, the part of the body submerged in water took the shape of the fish, while the upper half remained that of the goat. The constellation does look like half goat and half fish from this figure. Okay. The Indian name for Capricornus is Makar. Some 1400 years ago, Sun used to be in this constellation when passing through the southernmost part of the ecliptic, known as winter solstice. So when we celebrate Makar Sankrant, which falls on 22nd December, but at present, Sun enters Makar constellation in the third week of January. That is when we celebrate our Makar Sankrant, instead of 22nd December. Hence, 23 degrees south was called Tropic of Capricorn. This shift is due to precession movement of the Earth. If you want to better understand that, that can be a topic for our next session. What is the precession of Earth and how does that affect for these solstice points to move in the sky, to change from time to time. This shift is because of precession, as I told you. And the next constellation after Capricorn is Aquarius. Okay, this is an Aquarius. Okay. If I switch on the art, so these stars are joined together like this to form this constellation Aquarius. This constellation lies in the east of Capricorn. The name Aquarius means water barrier, and the origin of this name is believed to be in one legend from Greek mythology. Jupiter sent an eagle named Aquila to kidnap a beautiful shepherd youth named the Jupiter sent an eagle to kidnap a beautiful shepherd named Ganymede. The youth was arrived to this abode of gods against the wishes of his father. In this affair, Jupiter consoled the grieving father of Ganymede by giving him a pair of divine horse, and rewarded Ganymede by placing him as Aquarius, the cup bearer constellation. It is believed that the cup contained nectar and not plain water. The legend in Indian mythology of churning the ocean or Samudra Manthan, Capricorn, Aquila, that is the eagle, and the Hydra, the snake, are the participants. Okay, according to Indian mythology, during the Samudra Manthan, these three, which is the goat, which is Capricorn, Makar, the eagle, and the Hydra, the snake, are involved in the churning of the ocean. The sea snake forming the rope around the churning pillar in the legend. At present, the sun happens to be in Aquarius during the month of February. So during February, you will find that the sun is in this constellation. But in previous epoch, when the sun occupied this position for observers from Mesopotamia, it was the rainy season. And probably that explains the pictorial representation of Aquarius. which is like this. So since in the olden times, maybe this stories has this story or the structure has originated from Mesopotamia. When sun was in this constellation, it was a rainy season. Maybe that's why they have shown this Aquarius holding a pot with water. The next and final constellation in the zodiac sign is Pisces, which is this, which means fish and is a conspicuous constellation. According to Greek legend, a giant called Typhon made his appearance on the land and frightened even the gods, who fled to River Nile and hid themselves under assumed shape. So they took different shapes and they hid near the River Nile. Jupiter changed himself in an Aries. Pan took the form of goat, that is Capricorn, and the goddess Venus and her son Cupid jumped into the river and changed themselves into fishes. The shape of the constellation Pisces looks like two tied up fishes. You know, they do look like there are two fishes who are tied up together. In India, it is called Meen Rashi, Meena. The seven stars in this constellation, just a second. So in India, this is called Meen Rashi. The seven stars in this constellation, when connected up, make a polygon with seven slides. Starting from the left hand side, that is from here. If you move down left in its tail, the other fish resemble a kite flown with a string starting from the bright star called Kaithiyam. These are the Hindi names. A group of stars in this constellation is called Revati, which is also a constellation from the 20 is also a nakshatras from the 27 nakshatras. Okay. So these were the stories behind these constellations. There are many more constellations which are not possible to cover in just one session. There are stories, number of stories, more than one versions of stories behind every constellation that you see in the sky. And apart from these standard constellations, there are different asterisms. So asterisms are, group of stars which even you can connect. You can choose any random stars and connect them to form your own asterism. Just like, there are, in this Big Deeper, where is it? So there were few civilizations who saw this constellation as Bear, and few of them saw this as a Big Dipper, So even you can form your own shapes in the open night sky. One of the famous asterism is this. Here is this. There is an hibiscus flower in the sky, which I will try to show you. Okay. 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 So if you connect this shield of the Orion, okay, he's carrying a shield in his hand. Just try to follow this arrow and you will see a beautiful asterism, not a constellation, but an asterism, very famous among the amateur astronomers. So if you connect these stars here, this will form one leaf of the hibiscus flower, or leaf or petal, you can say, one petal of the hibiscus flower. This, the another one is this. This is the another petal, of the hibiscus flower. This one. Okay, can you see it? Is it making sense? If you join these, okay, these are the two petals, and in the center you will see the stem. This is a stem, and the Pleiades cluster on top of it. So this is the hibiscus flower in the sky. It is one of the famous asterism. Okay, I hope you can visualize this hibiscus flower. You will have to use your imagination to see this. Okay. So here I am ending the session. I hope you enjoyed the stories. If you have any query or any questions, you can ask. Okay, so most of my content was taken from a book called Hello Star, which is written by Usha Srinivasan. I would like to share that PDF with you. I do have that PDF. So if these stories has interested you, so you can read that book, which is a very small, around 60 or 70 pages book. I think I should share the link with you. Share file. So I have shared this book, which is distributed by Vigyan Prasar, Government of India. I would suggest you to read this book if you are fascinated by these stories or observations as whole. Yeah, thank you so much. I hope you have enjoyed. Yes, Urvi, I have shared this link in the chat box. Please do check for that PDF. Yes, we can hear you. Yes, Jay, we can hear you. Yeah, welcome. The pleasure is only mine.